bring Alyssa Armo into this and Jonathan Honig on what the long-term impact could be, because obviously the first thing you think of, and I'll begin with you, Jonathan, is that other industries take a look at the steel industry getting this support from the White House, and then a sort of a Me Too-ism builds up here. Now, Wall Street is the first to complain about that, but if memory serves me right, Wall Street was the beneficiary of a big federal grant, as it were, and a bailout of its own after the meltdown, and many other industries have experienced it. What is your sense of what this could lead to?
Well, this is setting up exactly that slippery slope, Neil, of more companies, more industries going to the government with their handout, demanding their piece of cronyism. You know, the Democrats had their cronyism with the Solyndra and the environment. This is the Republicans' version of cronyism, helping steel workers, helping the aluminum industry. I don't know, let's go back in the 70s. Maybe there's some Zenith television employees. They would like their jobs protected, Neil. I mean, this war, this trade war has already begun, but it's a trade war against American citizens who just want to, buy something cheaper so they can save some money for their families. This is terrible. No Democrat could do this type of harm to the free economy that Donald Trump is doing, Neil.
All right, I'm going to put you down as a maybe on this. Now, Melissa, I'm looking at all this and I'm wondering, I know markets fear the unknown and how widespread that. I understand also the prospect of inflation, of obviously if you're putting a tariff on a good, it makes that good more expensive and all of that. But I thought it was interesting this week that the Federal Reserve Chairman Jerome Powell had kind of expressed concerns about this, but kind of hoping that cooler heads would prevail. What do you think of that?
Well, I think that the market really fell more on him talking, the Fed chair talking this week, than it did on this tariff thing. I mean, you look at the chart, we rallied today. I don't know where we head next week. We definitely have to gap up Monday and follow through higher from the rally today. But I want to address Jonathan's point. We cannot survive or exist without the steel and aluminum industries. We need them. And right now, the U.S. is the largest importer of steel in the world. We can't survive without these industries.
Can I just question that premise? Why is that? Why can we not exist without foreign steel?
Well,
just
we're
like
not
we exist
level
without foreign
field.
Television. But why is that industry protected? Why do they deserve government handouts, government cronyism more than any other industry?
Listen, Trump is trying to get ahead of having to bail them out, like we did bail out the banks, like we did bail out the auto industry, because what we can't live without them. He doesn't want to have to bail them out like we bailed everybody
else
out.
Can you just answer that question? Why is it that we cannot live, that Americans cannot live without a domestic producer of steel? You haven't answered that question. Neither has the president.
Well, we can't. Because what if we would get in a war with North Korea? Were we going to get steel from China?
That's a fear that's been raised, that it's almost been heightened to a national security concern. I understand where that's coming from. But, Jonathan, your view is that once you make a carve-out for one industry, you make it for others. You made the same, of course, for the banking industry after the meltdown. You made the same for the housing and the mortgage industry, the auto industry. So you can make a compelling argument. But here's where I'll differentiate a little bit to her point, and that is that steel is sort of the bedrock. If everything hits the fan and we don't have enough of it here, or we're at a disadvantage here, we're certainly not going to be getting it from people who wish us ill, right?
That's right.
Neil, we have enough armaments, military armaments in this country to blow up North Korea or any other adversary by hundreds of times over. So that's a straw man. That's a red herring. That's not even worth addressing.
We needed steel, and we're increasingly, I see your point, Jonathan, but if we needed steel and we're increasingly reliant on those from abroad, we would be at a disadvantage, at least in the beginning, right?
If we needed steel, Neil, we would buy it. But what
from
you're
whom?
Doing by justifying
from our enemies?
But Neil, you're setting up this impossible situation of what if a war breaks out?
I just remember what it was like after Pearl Harbor, right?
Well, it's a longer discussion, Neil, I'll just put towards what you're offering as the remedy, central planning, a la Soviet Russia, a la Venezuela, where government picking winners and losers. So you can spin a fantasy about what if this breaks out, what if that breaks out?
Melissa, are we doing it because we've done it before where we've had a perfectly justified reason to support or help an industry? I was looking back in history, prior trade tiffs we've had. The steel industry has been back and forth to the White House numerous times, sometimes getting what they want, sometimes going back to John Kennedy, not getting what they want when he slapped them down for a price increase. But is that a dangerous trend? If that's expected, isn't that in and of itself a dangerous trend?
I don't still think it is because they need help. If you look at the charts, AKS still is worth $5. It used to be worth over $70 11 years ago. United Steel, look at the chart. That's in a downtrend. These companies, we might end up bailing them out because we need them to have, we need that industry in the U.S. You can buy from,
if need is the only justification for government involvement in the economy, then that's it, Neil. That's it. That's an economic
dictatorship. Well, then let me switch gears very quickly, guys. Do you think this has damaging impact on the markets? Melissa, I mean, let's see how this proceeds. If it escalates into the trade war, will this hurt the markets in that it gets to be inflationary, gets to be global friction? You know the drill. What do you think?
I think the markets are strong. I think the market's going to react to anything. It's going to react to certain people talking.
But not this, not
it's
this.
Well, it's going to react to this. It did. But whether it's going to change the trend of the market, no.
Jonathan.
Well, you know, I don't know if Donald Trump has read a book. He's certainly not a read history book. He would know that those who are repeating it are going to repeat it once again. Neil, look up Herbert Hoover. He enacted these exact type of trade tariffs in 1930. He turned what could have been a mild recession into a decade-long Great Depression. We're headed on the same road.
I remember talking to Hoover at the time and warned him about it. But thank you guys very, very much.
Thanks.
You know, there are young people in this room saying, Neil, talk to Herbert Hoover. All right, let me turn from the market storm to the real world.